While you're standing, turn your Bibles to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Can't stop, won't stop. Turn your Bibles to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 2. While you're standing, we begin with verse number 2. And so it is with me, brothers and sisters. When I came to you, I did not come to you with elegance or human wisdom, as I proclaimed to you the testimony about God. For I resolved to know nothing while I was with you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. I came to you in weakness and great fear and trembling. Verse 4, my message and my preaching were not with wise and persuasive words, but with a demonstration of the Spirit's power. In conclusion, verse 5, so that your faith may not rest on human wisdom, but on God's power. Can't stop, won't stop faith. Today we'll continue this series, take your seats, of Can't Stop, Won't Stop, with the subtext of Can't Stop, Won't Stop Faith. The Bible says it is faith that pleases God. I don't know how we can make it in this cruel, mean, violent, ungodly society without faith. We don't need more buildings. We don't need more political movements. We don't need more human ideas. We need more love. And love is birthed out of the fact that we are living on faith. Paul's letter here to the church at Corinth is a letter written in faith. Paul was talking to the church at Corinth during some very difficult and hostile times. It was as if Paul was writing this letter to the United States of America. Because as Paul was writing this letter, all kind of foul and violent things were occurring in society. On last week, we talked about what was going on in the world during the days of Noah. And the Bible said that whatever a man put his mind to do, no matter how foul and ungodly, he was capable of doing it. And God wiped out the earth with a flood. And now we're seeing here in the New Testament, Paul is writing a letter to the church at Corinth, because the church at Corinth is in the midst of chaos, in the midst of violence, in the midst of destruction. People are being persecuted for the mere fact that they are saying that I am Christ. Like, people are losing their lives for what they believed in. And Paul writes this letter to the church at Corinth in some very difficult times. But before we deal with the letter Paul writes to the church at Corinth and to the people of Corinth, let's look at both the author and the audience so we can declare we have can't stop, won't stop faith. And if we have can't stop, won't stop faith, we can accomplish something great for God this season. I got enough faith to believe that we can make a difference. I got enough faith to believe that no matter what I see on the news, no matter what I read in the newspaper, no matter what CNN says, and no matter what the political agenda is, I got enough faith to believe that if we keep believing, if we keep trusting God, if we keep preaching with power and authority, if we keep being the walking love of Christ, if we keep demonstrating what the church should be and not what the church is, I just believe that we can really one day live in a society where there is no more bloodshed. I really believe that we can create a society where people are loving one another. I stated earlier at the early location that it's amazing to me that if you go to a playground and you take some Caucasian kids and some African American kids and some Hispanic kids and some Asian kids and kids from all walks of life, and you drop them off at a playground, they will start calling one another friend, and they will start playing with one another because they have not been contaminated with hatred and racism and violence. And what happens is, as we grow up and we form all these different ideas and concepts, and I stop calling you my friend, my brother, because you look different than I. You may sound different than me, so now we're enemies, but we're really not enemies. We're just confused because we have separated love and faith, and now we are selfish, and now we're self-centered. But I believe that if we walk by faith and not by sight, we can turn America great again. And I'm not talking about the America that Donald Trump is talking about. I'm talking about America where my skin color and gender won't matter. I'm talking talk about a miracle, and that's the king dream. And I got enough crazy faith to believe that if we have a can't stop, won't stop attitude of faith, that we can make a difference in this dark, sinful world we live in. I may be alone, but I just believe if we keep believing, and if we keep declaring, and if we keep being what Christ said, Christ, like, we can make a difference. Am I talking to anybody here this morning? Is anybody sick and tired of being sick and tired, and you made your mind up, I'm going to have a can't stop, won't stop kind of faith?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes.
Watch this. Paul, as we all know, was once known as Saul.
Amen.
A.K.A. also known as. And the reason I want to drop this in is because sometimes Satan will convince you that you're not worthy to live by faith.
My God, my God.
Satan will have you believing that the mistakes of your past have canceled your destiny, your future, and your purpose. But Saul was what my grandmother would have called a booger man. Saul was a person that was violent. Saul was a person that was destroying the church. But God changed Saul to Paul. Watch this. A man who took great pride in killing and destroying the church is now the leader of the church movement. Why am I stressing this? Because if God can take Saul and give him a new life and call him Paul, then we can declare, no matter who we are or where we've been or what we've been, that yes, God can. I want you to make up your mind this morning. Yes, God can turn your life around. Yes, God can use you. Yes, God can. Yes, God did, and yes, God will, but you got to make your mind up that I'm worthy. You got to make your mind up that if I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired, I can't stand on the sideline watching somebody else work out. I got to get involved in this thing called life. Is there anybody here this morning and you make your mind up? I want to be a vessel in my family. I want to be a vessel in my community. I want to be a vessel in my city. And I'm going to operate with enough can't stop, won't stop faith where I will be a difference maker. I'm sick and tired of complaining. That didn't work. I'm sick and tired of whining. That didn't work. I'm sick and tired of blaming. That didn't work. Stop getting so riled up when a man in blue killed one of us, but you won't get upset when we killing one another. It's time out for anybody dying on our. I'm mad when anybody gets gunned down. I'm sick and tired, and I got enough faith to believe that we can not only stop them from killing us, but we can stop us from killing us.
Out of all the people on the planet, today there are approximately 7.4 billion people in the world. About 312 million citizens of this United States of America. Yet God chose somebody like Paul.
Can you
imagine? Can you imagine? But I can imagine over in Europe, they're wondering how out of 312 million people, the best candidate that the United States over was Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton.
Oh!
Yes. Can you a pool of 312 million, and that's the best of the best? But I'm sure during Paul's time, they will say, out of all the people on the earth, out of all the people in the town, out of all the people in the city, why would God choose somebody like Paul? So one day, you and I could say, if God chose Paul, then God surely can choose somebody like you and I, so we can step up and stand out and speak out and be accounted for. God used Saul and turned to Paul, so one day, you and I could be used by God.
Yeah,
I often ask myself, why me, God?
Nah.
Then I think about, He chose me.
Yeah.
He saved me. He chose me. He saved me. And that causes me to not only break out with a can't stop, won't stop level of faith, but it also causes a can't stop, won't stop praise to break out. And I dare you right now to give God praise right now for choosing you, to give God praise right now for waking you up this morning, for giving God praise. He didn't let your past cancel your future. I dare somebody right now to give God a round of praise for picking you, for choosing you, for giving you the ability, for giving you the skill set, for giving you a new mindset. See, you should have been gone a long time ago. Some things you've done, you been disqualified. Yet, Darby, I'm a keeper in the game. I'm a keeper in that first baby you had out of wedlock. That should have been the end of your story. That last domestic violence resume, that should have been the end. But Darby, I'm a keeper anyhow. Is there anybody here this morning and you're glad God kept you? Out of all the self-righteous,
come on here,
holding and down people,
come on here,
God yet chose you.
Come on,
that'll make you keep going.
Yes.
Whenever I feel like I may want to quit, I'll think about what he did for me.
Yeah.
I'll think about all my grandmother's answered prayers.
Yes.
I'll think about all the people who prayed for me and encouraged me. I can't stop, won't stop. I wish I had somebody in this audience that wasn't selfish and you wasn't feeling like you were entitled, but you realized it was somebody's prayer, it was somebody's encouragement that kept you going. And because they kept you going, now you're in your right mind. You didn't just go through college on your own. You don't just have that job on your own. You're not living house on your own. You're not driving that on your own. It was somebody that prayed for you. It was somebody that encouraged you. Now I dare you not sit around whining and complaining, but the same way somebody prayed you through, get involved.
God
is not afraid of where you're at. God is only concerned about where you're going if you allow him to guide you. That's why it blows me away when church people say, Pastor, I'm praying for you, but I ain't want that in the streets. Them people crazy out there. Them people dead. The same people you're afraid of, you used to be in them.
You used to be them people.
And when we forget about what God brought us through and what God brought us out, then we've lost our voice. And if you lose your voice, you've lost your power. And a church without power is really not a church, but an organization. And we have too many organizations on too many blocks. We have too many gathering places, but you're gathering just to gather. But if you're not going to gather to gain power, and the only way you gain power, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We're not gathering just to gather. We're gathering to get information. We're gathering to be empowered to take what we've learned inside to the outside so an unsaved world can know that God still works. God still works.
Yes, he does.
Yes, he does.
The problem is there's too many judges inside and outside your head. And you can't operate with a can't stop, won't stop attitude, allowing the thoughts of others to control you. You must let yourself be great. You gotta first forgive yourself.
All right.
And then stop letting other people rule you.
Wow.
Daily, I get hundreds, close to thousands of compliments daily. But every now and then, somebody will pop up and say something crazy, something critical, something negative. And I've learned how not to focus on any negativity, not to get too high about the praises, but not to get low with the negative. Because at the end of the day, it's not about me nor you. It's about God. And I've discovered the way you deal with people and their ideas and their negativity. This week, I had a pastor call and say, Pastor, somebody said something bad about you in my inbox. I say, tell them, thank you for spreading my brand, but don't tell me who they were, because if they ever need me, I don't want to be able to operate with presence. So no, I don't even know who they are. Just tell them, thank you for spreading my brand, and if they ever need me, I'm here. You got to learn how to not let the voice of other people who wish they can do what you're doing. See, the problem is, when God starts using you, people on the sideline will get mad and envious, and they'll try to critique you. They'll try to be Monday morning quarterbacks when they've never thrown a pass in their life. They've never been on the center in their life. Yet they don't tell you what you think. That was me. Well, everybody has the opportunity to get involved. Everybody has the opportunity to make a difference. Stop letting people talk you out of what God has called you to do. Stop letting those voices tell you you can't be a black man and be successful without selling out. You keep doing what you're doing. You keep going through the process. Keep letting God develop you and mold you. Stop letting negative voices cancel you.
Come on, Pastor Jeff.
They sad because of your relationship or lack of relationship with your daddy. They tried to put you in a box, yet God gave you speed and you outran the box. They said because you had a child or wedlock and that relationship didn't work, this didn't work, you would never be anything. Yet God took that situation and God gave you power and authority. He gave you a voice. I tell sisters, stand up and say, he may have left me, but that's when God came in my life.
Yeah. Won't stop. All right.
So this audience that Paul was talking to, let's look at it. Corinth. If it was written, the story today, it wouldn't be Corinth. It would be the United States of America. Because you can compare the culture of Corinth to Las Vegas,
Jesus,
where everything goes and everything stays.
Talk, man.
New Orleans doing Mardi Gras, the police turn their heads and let things go. This word, they create this phrase, the Greeks create this phrase called to act Corinthian. You know, we have our own phrase to act black, to act ghetto. It just simply means to be out of order.
Wow.
They create a phrase, act Corinthian, which means that we're going to act out of order. We're going to, where everything goes. That's how it is now in America. In America, it's no longer sin. It's no longer wrong unless you get caught.
Jesus.
And everything is good, dude. Just be you and do you until you get caught. And then you start feeling some kind of way.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
That's not what the church should be representing.
Because
I understand. I'm not talking about the sinners. I'm not talking about the world. I'm talking about the church. The church should be an example. The church should set a bar. We shouldn't be acting like the world. We should be leading the world to Christ. We shouldn't be sounding like, smelling like, responding like the world. If we are going to be the church, if we are going to be the power source, if we're going to be the light of the world, we got to make our minds up. We got to raise the bar and raise the standard so we can win the world.
Good man of God. That's good, preacher.
Yes.
Paul was a man who had a past.
Amen.
But he was assigned by God to build the church.
Wow.
More importantly, he was assigned by God to build a generation of people to serve God in the midst of the sin capital. Watch this. In the midst of chaos.
Come on.
God says, go and be the light.
Jesus.
Let me say it again. In the midst of chaos.
Uh-huh.
God says, go
be
and
the
be
light. The light.
The light. Or somebody should be jumping up saying, God, if you need somebody, go, I'll go. God, if you need somebody to pray, I'll pray. God, if you need somebody to march, I'll march. God, if you need somebody to speak,
on,
I'll speak.
Pastor,
God, if you need somebody should jump. God, if you need somebody, I'll go.
Yeah, Lord.
In the midst of chaos.
Uh-huh.
God calls a man with a past. Say, you go.
Come on, Pastor Decker.
And win this generation. Christ.
Talk, Pastor.
The other night I was in a very violent setting. A murder had taken place hours earlier. I couldn't find anybody to roll with me, so that don't ever stop me. So I rolled up and it was hostile. But the little preacher, when he got out of his truck, even the gangster started saying, yes, sir.
Jesus.
The parking was all jammed up, called it where he said, open it up and let the preacher do.
Jesus.
And I got out and said, whatever we can do while you're here, we here for you.
My God.
A guy showed up from a funeral home and said, how did you get that kind of control? I said, it's not me.
That's right. That's right.
But real understands real.
Yeah.
And the streets are sick and tired of being pimped by the church. The streets are sick and tired of us saying, come in, give us some money, but they never show up on the outside. The world is sick and tired. The world is sick and tired of you saying, let me pray for you, but then you only pray for me based on what I give you. The world is ready for the church to really be the church. See, I told her the early morning service, they get some nuggets. I told her that the Black Lives Movement is the first movement in America that was not generated and led by the church. But the reason the Black Lives Movement, which were led by millennials, are not being led by the church, because they're sick and tired of being disappointed by the church. They're sick and tired of coming to church, being told to sit in their place and be quiet while police officers gunning us down, and while we're gunning one another down, and while they're closing up schools and building jails, while they're setting us up for failure. These young people say, I'm sick and tired of the church having prayer meetings with no power. I'm sick and tired of you taking my grandmother's money, but when my grandmother got sick, you weren't there to help her. I'm sick and tired of the church telling us that they are the beacon of light, but they're never around when we need them. So this generation, the head of the church, we're going to get the answers ourselves. That's why it's so hard for you to get your children to come to church now.
My God.
They're tired of being burnt.
Help us, God.
By people who speak love but don't show love.
Help us, God.
I'm not concerned about getting invited to the social gathering of pastors. That's not my role.
Help us, God.
I'm concerned about the little man on the street. I'm concerned about the people who've lost hope. It's time the church became a place you can regain yourself. A place you can find yourself. Yeah. A place you can discover genuine love and authentic caring.
Yes.
So God tells Paul. And the reason God can tell Paul, because Paul knows what it means to be on both sides. Paul knew what it meant to be on both sides.
Come on,
God's going to raise a man of faith to lead the people of faith. That's why I can't stop, won't stop. God has been too good to me. Is there anybody here that have experienced the grace of God the most? Has God been, I know God's been good to me, but has God been good to anybody else? Well, if God's been good to you, you at least owe God to help somebody else. The church should stop pointing his finger and start extending his hand.
Yeah, wow. That's good, Pastor Decker. Right.
Yeah, that's good, real preaching.
Jesus.
All right.
I'm convinced.
All right.
Unapologetically convinced. That God called me for this generation.
Yes.
To be a voice. Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
To be a bridge. Yes, Lord. To be a light. Can't stop, won't stop faith. I just told you about my experience in Cross, the place of poverty, but I always got to tell you is, in the midst of all that, 26 souls gave their life to Christ.
Amen.
Now, I was getting let me make sure I got the right terminology. I was getting up. You know when you get high, but you ain't smoking, but you're getting high anyway? Thank you, preacher. I was getting a contact high. I started getting hit. I'm getting dizzy. I'm getting a headache. Yeah. But I kept declaring.
Yeah.
And I said, if there's anybody here that wanna make Jesus the center of their life, one lady threw her hand up and said, yes, me! And I'm like, me! All around in the midst of the dope.
Jesus.
In the midst of young men grabbing their guns, in the midst of gangbangers looking around to make sure that they were still in control, people start saying yes to Jesus. Yes to Jesus. Yes to Jesus. I took my phone and said, give me your name and number. And I gave them the right to the church and said, you are now a Christian. But in the next morning, the next day, I contacted each of them and said, I'm proud of the decision you made last night. It's my personal number, my personal reputation. I'm now your pastor. I'm now the man that's going to pray for you daily. And that evening, I kept getting phone calls and kept getting messages. Some of the hearts, I didn't know the minute first, the hearts mean they like what you're saying. Oh, they start responding back. We thank you, Pastor.
Jesus.
Before I showed up, they were grieving with bloodshed. Now they said, thank you, Pastor. I'm determined, Deacon. I'm going to take the hood. If I got to be a one-man army, can't stop, won't stop. I got the faith. I can restore the hood. Is there anybody that said, Pastor, I'll go with you. I'll take the city with you. Gulf Coast appointments.
Come on, Pastor Decker.
South Lund.
Yeah.
Ran into one of the most dangerous cities, not just in Houston, but in the United States of America.
Yeah.
The leader of the most notorious gang calls me on a daily basis for mentorship.
Wow.
Bless the Lord.
Greens Point. Police call it Guns Point. Was setting up sub-ministries to rebuild the community.
Amen.
Fourth Ward and Fifth Ward, we don't call them wards, we call them communities. We're going back and take the city.
Jesus.
Not concerned about, Pastor, where your church actually at? Where your church actually at? Say, it's everywhere.
No.
Yeah. I'm no longer confined by four walls. Wherever there's needs, that's where the church is. It's in a courtroom one day. It's in an apartment complex the other day. It's in a back alley the other day. Wherever the needs are, that's what the church is. I believe that's the church that Jesus called. Upon this rock, I will build my church. Jesus never said get stuck in a church. When you get stuck in a church, you're now stuck in a box. And he didn't call us to be stuck in a box. He called us to have can't stop, won't stop faith. That's why this generation is turning their back on the church. But we're telling them to come to us. And they say, no, come to us.
Jesus.
If you're afraid of them,
my God.
You need to check your faith.
My God. My God.
You need to check your faith.
Help us, Pastor Decker.
Question. How can a messed up man lead a group of messed up people into a God kind of life?
Well.
Oh, man.
How can it happen?
Yeah.
Faith.
Come on. Bring the text, man of
faith
God.
Faith is like a magnet.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
A magnet draws its own kind to it. But fear is also a magnetic force. Either you're drawn to fear or you're drawn to faith.
Uh-huh.
I was so blessed yesterday. Friday night, I got a phone call saying, when I preached the funeral of Minister Davis' sister at the last minute, and I said, yes, it's easy because I had a chance to talk to her on her deathbed before cancer took all the way out, and she told her children in front of me, she says, don't let fear win, but let faith win over fear. And that's why God can take somebody. Darren, that's why God can use you, because faith is like a magnet, and if you walk in faith, then faith will draw everything to you that you need in your life. But if you walk in fear, fear will draw everything you don't need in your life. And let me tell you, the only way Satan can come in is in an atmosphere of fear. Satan strives when people are afraid. Satan dominates when fear dominates. We gotta run fear out of church, and we have to be a people that's walking by faith. Because if you're walking by faith, you will draw people unto you. If I be lifted up, says the Lord, I'll draw all men unto me. If you walk by faith, God will use you.
Rest away, man of God.
Oh, God will use you if you walk by faith. Faith comes by hearing the word.
Yes.
Faith is the ability to see what others can't see yet.
My God.
Faith is the ability to see what others can't see yet.
Yeah.
I know.
Yes.
What's broken?
Uh-huh.
I know what's wrong with me.
Uh-huh.
I know my issues.
Yes.
Faith is not recycling and regurgitating my issues.
Uh-huh.
Faith is telling me you see something different in me that I don't see in myself.
Come on, Pastor. Come on, Pastor.
Faith is me being able to look beyond your now and seeing your tomorrow.
Jesus.
And speaking to you as if you're already your tomorrow while you're struggling in your tonight. Do you have enough faith to look in the mirror at yourself, not as what you see right now, but to speak about yourself, not in the now, but in the God? Because when you speak in the God, you're saying that no matter what I see now, I'm not limited to now, but I'm believing God's going to do something great in my life. And if I feel that way about myself, I got to feel that way about you, because I can't be selfish. I can't say God won't work it out in my life and God won't do a great thing in my life and not declare the same thing in your life. Because if God can do it for me, then God can do it for you. And that's how you change the atmosphere and the attitude of a society. You got to see the best in you, and then what you see in you, you got to penetrate that in somebody else. Start declaring right now, somebody is better. Start declaring right now, somebody is greater. Start declaring right now. Don't tell him, I see you looking like this. Tell him, I see you in another.
I see it, man of God. Jesus.
Paul is an example of what can happen. And I wonder, is there anybody here that can see themselves being a modern day example of the unlimited possibilities of what can happen with a can't stop, won't stop attitude?
Yes, Lord.
Paul was an example of what can happen if you let God.
Yes.
I know what Mama them said. I know what people have said. Many of you have been written off. But when you let God be God, you are operating in an atmosphere of unlimited possibilities.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Paul shouldn't have been qualified. Shouldn't have been used.
Shouldn't have been.
But somebody say, but God.
But God.
Somebody say, but God.
But God.
And Paul, Paul says, my testimony is not about me, but about God.
Yes.
Paul says he gave his son Jesus. And he raised his son Jesus from the dead. Paul says, the reason I'm effective is I'm telling him about the testimony of God. That's why I'm telling you, you can't get too high when folks say something good about you, but you can't get too low when they say something bad about you. You gotta keep it on God. Because when the devil does, the devil will allow you to start admiring your own press clippings. The devil will have you believing that now it's about you, and once you get in that mindset that it's about you, then God say, okay, if it's about you, let me step back.
Yeah.
And I don't know about you, but I don't want to live in this messed up, violent, cruel, ungodly world without God being my source and without God being my force. Because when I have God, this off script. It wasn't planned, but this, can I get Daisy Williams to stand up? And this off script. It wasn't planned. I gotta do obedience to the Holy Spirit. I'm gonna interview her another day, but this mother and this father, their son was murdered with a pair of filthy Jordans. Their son was gunned down over some Jordan tennis shoes. You seen in the headlines in the news, trial to trial, four young black men killed their son over a pair of Jordan tennis shoes. But this mother and this father too, but the father is more the father. I'm still working on him. But that mother right there, that mother, she looked at her son's killer and said, I love you, I forgive you, and can I come visit you in jail? I said, what kind of
Jesus!
And she wasn't doing it for cameras. She wasn't doing it for pop. She said, son, I know where your birthday is. On your birthday, I pray for you. She said, I forgive you. As a thing, you realize you are what God said we should be. I told her, I'm impressed by you because you're being what I should be being.
Yes.
You are walking around being Christ-like. And I wonder how many of us in here have that kind of can't stop, won't stop faith, but we can forgive somebody just like that, that God can do something great in our life. And if she wouldn't have forgiven them for it, she would have been stuck in a box of hatred, a box of grief. But now God is doing something great in their life because they released the Spirit of God. It ain't about me, it's about God. Oh, I can have somebody holler, it ain't about me, it's about God. I would have lost my mind a long time ago. I would have threw the call a long time ago. I would have quit a long time ago. It ain't about me, it's about God. Is there anybody here and that's your story? It ain't about me, it's about God. Paul says, I came to you in weakness, but I realize God is strong. Paul says, I came to you in fear, but I realize God didn't give me the spirit of fear, but of power and of promise. Paul says, I came to you with much trembling, but then I realized I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. Paul says again, it's not about me, but the demonstration of the Spirit and the power that the Spirit indwells. Paul says, I got a can't stop, won't stop attitude because Jesus keeps me going.
Yes.
Jesus keeps me going.
Yeah.
Jesus keeps me going. If you go on your own, you're going to quit, give up, and go in the town. But if you go, because Jesus is your strength.
Yeah.
Jesus is your source. Let me laugh at myself for a little while. On Monday night, we had marriage ministry. And after marriage ministry, I got in my vehicle, baby, and I turned the key on, and ain't nothing happened. See, now this is strange. Ain't nothing happened. Luckily, I had Mr. Hespec there. He's an auto mechanic genius. He said, Pastor, pop the hood. One guy was saying, you probably need a battery. Another guy said, you probably need an accelerator. Another guy said, you probably need an engine. Wife said, you probably need a whole new vehicle. But Hespet opened the trunk, or opened the hood. He started looking around. While everybody else was speculating, he started touching. He said, Pastor, this the problem. Your cable to your battery has gotten loose. Your cable to your battery has gotten loose. So you're not getting enough juice. I heard a sermon in the loose cable. Your cable is loose and you're not getting enough juice. That's what happens when you don't have enough Jesus. Your cable is loose. You're not getting enough juice. That's why you're still cussing folks out. Your cable is loose. You don't have enough Jesus. That's why you're still lying and gossiping. Your cable is loose. You don't have enough juice. That's why you're walking around while you're depressed, mad, and sad. Your cable is loose. You don't have enough juice. But as soon as they tightened up my cable, and the cable connected to the battery, I put the key back in. And this season, if you keep connected with Jesus, this season, if you get connected with Jesus, that's why you can't go nowhere. That's why you're stuck in place. That's why you're right where you're at last year. You've been in the same spot you've been in the last 3 years. Proper line about you next in line. You can be next in line all you want to, but if you connect with Jesus, you ain't going nowhere. And I gotta let you go now, but my final word I gotta tell you is, when you keep reading the text, when you jump down to verse number 9, it says, however it is written, no eye has seen and no ear has heard what great things the Lord has conceived for you. The thing God has prepared for those who love him. That's why we gotta have a can't stop, won't stop attitude. I can't stop because the future is too bright. I can't stop because what God has prepared for me and prepared for you, it is for me and it is for you. You can't get stuck in the now. You gotta see beyond the now. You gotta see what God has next. And every time you get ready to stop, every time you get ready to quit, you gotta look into your future and say, I can't stop because eyes have not seen. I can't stop because ears have not heard what wonderful and marvelous and great things the Lord is getting ready to do in my life. Won't stop spirit. I can't stop. Won't stop attitude. God has laid up too much for you. God has too much in store for you. If you quit now, saw you the sound of my voice, you real close to your breakthrough, real close to your deliverance, real close to your miracle, real close to your promotion. But the closer you get, the more aggressive the devil gonna get. So don't be moved by the devil. Don't be moved by your enemies. Don't be moved by the critics. Just make your mind up. Eyes have not seen, ears have not heard. Let me go get what God has for me. That's all, y'all.